Today I want to talk about a very profound book I read recently, a very profound book that I read just before Christmas, and it changed my whole mind and my whole idea of staying on social media such as Facebook and how I would even present myself on the internet from that point on. Like so many of you, when I would think of something, it would appear on my Facebook feed, an ad or some other interest that I was interested in or something I was thinking about. And the more visceral a thought was, the more likely that it was to appear. So if something was annoying me or upsetting me, something was problematic, it would be more likely to show up quicker. But even casual things, but things that I was like hobbies and stuff I was interested in, those posts wouldn't show up. It was almost like Facebook AI neural interface, which is very real, I can tell you that for a fact, was looking for the real me. This was later confirmed another point by someone I spoke to who works for Facebook, not work for them, that this person, like so many Facebook employees are and Google employees, are blowing secrets. Now, where they're getting the majority of the data from, this AI neural interface, is not on your regular Facebook page where you post pictures of your kids and what you had for dinner or where you went to, from your private messages and from private message boards or message boards that you're on. The reason for this being that Facebook considers that to be your real true self. There's the real you in there. Post your true feelings and your true self-identity. Message boards or in private messages. That's where the data harvesting is taking place, and that's being fed directly into this AI neural interface. Two ways of looking at it. An example, started to develop appeared to be clairvoyancy on Facebook. It was almost like I could predict things or the future. I could see things coming down the road. First, you're kind of led into a kind of a false egotistical dichotomy that you're somehow, you are a highly clairvoyant person and you have this ability to read the future or perceive that you can read people's minds. It's not like that at all. Actually think, not that wild when you think about it, what Facebook is actually really up to. AI neural interface is creating a dissociation in everyone's mind who are sharing emotional feelings or emotional behaviors on, massive raven just flew by, on, creates a dissociation in their minds. And what that does is it's creating the AI neural interface version of you to replace the real version of you. Now, a dissociated version of what they once were, and all you have to do is see how distorted they are from regular people in order to understand just how powerful this thing is. When I say regular people, I mean traditionally being in society. The effect of this is that it's almost like on a spiritual level, you over and possess you. Now you've heard me talk about things like the digital djinn and how Corazon 333 is almost certainly going to move into the cyber world, the social media world. Now, that doesn't have to necessarily be a belief in demons or djinns or anything like that. In sort of like supernatural sense, it could, you know, these things are also referring to things like dissociation within consciousness. Now, dissociation in consciousness can be done in lots of ways. Through altering your thinking by beginning to give you things that you think you need from Facebook. And that's just basic ads that have monitored your thoughts or your interest or your posts on the internet, and then accordingly sold you, tried to sell you products and ideas and information to the data that they have harvested from you. Minor form of dissociation, that's like if you go back to, you know, the whole, right back to Edward Bernays, this kind of dissociation, this idea of this kind of association has been around a very, very long time. We just live in an age where things move rapidly and much, much quicker. For them is instantaneous. Other form of dissociation of creating a substitute facsimile of yourself to believe that's now the real you that's been created by the Facebook social media. See, this is why this Facebook still looks like shit after all these years. It still has that, you know, 12-year-old interface engine in it. It's because all the work is behind the scenes. Really, like an image of Zuckerberg, the plain nerd on the surface who's like this monster behind it all. That's why it's a plain, boring-looking interface. It's to lure you into a false sense of security, that it doesn't look sinister in any way. The color blue is often used by cults on their websites. Blue is a color that makes you feel relaxed. It doesn't trigger you into a state of anxiety, say like red would trigger you into that. At the same time too, it doesn't impose a sense of specialness or exclusivity in the way that sort of color purple does. Now, this book that I read was entitled The Strange Frequencies, The Extraordinary Story of Technology's Quest for the Supernatural, and it was written by Peter Berbergal. He wrote that book, Season of the Witch, about the occult and rock and roll. I highly recommend Strange Frequencies. In fact, the book has actually changed me. I actually felt my consciousness shifting during the book. He talks about so many of the things that I've been talking about in recent years, but because he has the resources and the ability to do it, he's presented it much better. The idea of the golem. You've always heard me talk about the meat golem and then the digital golem. The idea of the automaton, the marionette. These are things I've talked about for years. This has been the idea to create this supernatural facsimile of the person as a technological substitute, and we are now in this age of doing this, and that's what makes this book Strange Frequencies by Peter Berbergal so powerful. I actually felt a consciousness shift. I cannot recommend this book enough. It's also one of the reasons it has not been getting that much attention. There's lots of rubbish books out there that have been getting loads of attention. Strange Frequencies will reconfirm a lot of the work that I put out over the years. You will read that and you'll say you'll recognize it from what I've made videos and endless broadcasts and written about, except it's done in a much, much better and clearer way. I have great admiration for how Peter Berbergal actually presented this on this realization and the increasing theocratic elevation of the digital magi, if you want to call them that. And they're actually doing to us what Rabbi Lodz did to the golem Yosef. And this is the basic, it's coming into fruition in the next few years. Now, you know me, I'm not a pessimist, I tend to be an optimist about most things. If I have a problem with something, I just generally walk away from it. I don't sit around and waste my energy that I need for other things dealing with it. So what is the solution here? Well, the first thing is, if you remain on something like Facebook, you've really got to consider how you present and the way you present yourself on there. You've got to really look and think, are you putting too much of your feelings out there? You especially cannot trust any private message. You're safer actually putting on the Facebook wall than you are on any private message or any group, secret, closed or otherwise, because that's where the majority of the data harvesting is taking place. So that's important. It's a very, very important one. The other aspect of it is how you even present yourself within the digital world. I've been thinking about this a lot as I've been traveling around the world myself in recent times and seeing different cultures. I decided I was far too Eurocentric in my thinking, and not because I'm like, you know, and turning into a SJW. I just realized I was, and I needed to go out and see other cultures and look at other spiritual traditions such as Buddhism and Sufism and Hinduism, and see was there anything in there, and meet people from these cultures in these cultures. And I learned an awful lot. I learned an incredible amount. And what I learned most of all is that you must hang on to your real self at any cost, because once that's gone, you will end up what people in indigenous societies used to call soul loss. And soul loss meant literally that you lose your soul, and you don't know who you are anymore, because you're not having the thoughts that should originate from what inside you. And you have shamanic traditions all over the world who take a great interest in this and take this idea of soul loss extremely seriously. And here we are in the West using social media, and that's also why I've moved on to Instagram away from Facebook, because Instagram allows me to communicate more in symbols and pictures, the same way I've been doing on YouTube, which will always be my main outlet, in symbols and pictures, in absurdist ideas, so as be elusive to the AI neural interface. I've always been absurdist in my approach on the internet since I got into Usenet 20 odd years ago. I've always seen it as a kind of a comedy outlet, an absurdist, surrealist way of escaping the detection of the machine. I think I was subconsciously always feeling it, and now I consciously feel it. But there's even other things to do, like perhaps instead of like putting your picture all over the internet, create something like a sigil or a symbol that represents you, the AI neural interface, and not have something like a picture of the Abrahamic symbols being thrown in a rubbish bin, because that already gives away too much information. Your sigil should be something unique to you that you've designed based on how, well, everyone knows my sigil, and as I've had that for many years, on how you feel. You could do things like, remember, it doesn't start and begin with the internet. It's things involved like, this is one of the things where we have to have cash. Cash still gives us a way of controlling their effects over us. So for instance, you could do things like, if you're taking money out of an ATM, you could say, go to buy groceries at the automatic teller. I know that not the most ethical ways of shopping in the world, but you can put your protective sigil back on the cash that you've withdrawn from the machine. Write it in a pen or something like that, or thin marker, and then feed that cash back into the automatic checkout machines, and then you've actually kind of, in psychologically, even if it's not true on the surface, you've actually protected yourself at some level. You've given yourself an element of psychic insurgency against the AI thing. Eventually, your sigil will show up in all kinds of places, not just on your Facebook page or your Instagram page or YouTube channel. It will show up on the digital system everywhere. It will create a sense of absurdity and confusion within the AI interface, to the point where what you are using to rep yourself, that being the symbol or the sigil of yourself, is not identifiable according to the criteria needed by the Facebook neural interface or by the machine itself or whatever, in order to constantly track you. You become something of an enigma, and that enigma they cannot put a badge on, and therefore you're quite safe. And the new priest class are the ones sitting in Silicon Valley. I'll still continue to make films, and hopefully the quality will be much better and much more interesting. But and thank you for those of you who stuck by me. It's been a very interesting few months. I've timed a lot of this according to lunar cycles. This brings me to the most final and important part of this. The primary aspect of the AI neural interface and its need to create dissociation within people on social media is to alter the clock speed of their brains. So therefore, they're living in the past. An artificial lag in the clock speed of their brains has been created. This lag allows them to create the future before you're aware of it, in real time. That's why so many people, and have told me, and I've experienced myself, they've had a sense of deja vu when they were reading Facebook. They would see, and they would think about something, and it would come along, and they say, this didn't already happen. And this also brings us down to things like the Mandela effect. I'm starting to think that Mandela effect may have a lot of truth to it. Not as the way it's been pushed out there, but if you alter the clock speeds of the human cognition, you can basically live in a future that we don't live in. So for example, they could actually be living in a reality that's microseconds ahead of us, because we have been altered through the entire, what they call, Internet of Things, to have a lag of several seconds or several hours or several days behind them. It's the new feudal system. They're not moving into the top of the pyramid anymore. They've left the pyramid and they're now moving into another reality. They're controlling us like technical gods. And you and anyone listening to this really need to take this information in, especially if you have children. Keep them away as much as possible from the internet, and if they're on it, tell them to do things like not upload photographs in real time, not post statuses of where they're traveling, not do anything like that. Upload old photographs or schedule them and for the future. I think that would be a huge step forward in the right direction. What we can do is cause enough confusion where they're not going to get away with what they want to get away with. Remember, at the end of the day, it's only going to be your ass that anyone is ever going to care about. And that's unfortunate, but that's life.